Good morning. And a very warm welcome to St. Martin's this morning. At least it's warm, because that's how we know it's summer, because the rain's warmer than it is in the winter. And well done to so many folk for coming out this morning in such a miserable day. I was heading on Thursday to the Magic Circle, which is in Paul Beth in West Calder. And I had to turn back after an hour because they had shut the A720. The flooding was so bad. But I was fortunate that only took me 40 minutes to get to Straighton to turn back. So it really was quite some end to the week. Some intimations at the end of today's service. If you can just have a wee stretch for 2 minutes while we move the table, and then we'll move straight into our stated annual meeting. You should have had a copy of the account summary and the minutes of last year's meeting, which means we don't have to read them all, the minutes all out before the meeting. So we thought we'd give you that pleasure. And we'll go straight into the meeting, and then we'll have our tea and coffee after that. So please do stay if you can. Believe it or not, this is the last Sunday in May. And so being the first Sunday in June next week, we will celebrate the sacrament of Holy Communion at our service next Sunday morning. Singing group meets this Tuesday at 7:30. Our cinema, the next community cinema, is the 7th of June at 7 p.m. and we'll be showing The Miracle Club. And Still Game meets this Friday at 2 p.m. and they'll be having an afternoon of bingo. So come along to that on Friday at 2 p.m. That's everything I've got. I don't have any notices of birthdays or celebrations this week. Is there anything? No? Okay. Oh, aye, it was Fraser was 10 yesterday, our grandson, so we were through seeing them. We were actually supposed to be, he wanted to go into the Lego shop in Glasgow, and I was standing ironing my shirt, and I thought, wait a minute. So I phoned Rachel and said, let's not go to Glasgow today, because it was the cup final, Rangers and Celtic, and some folk will have been drinking since the last time they played in the final about 12 years ago, and so we decided not to, so we just went through to see them, but I think they're going in this afternoon. But it was vindicated by a friend of Rachel's later on to say her and her husband were driving in Glasgow in the city centre, and their car got hit by a bottle. And that was during the game. Now, no even a Ranger supporter can throw a bottle from Mount Florida. So there were still some folk actually in the town centre, and this is the problem with these games. And do you know, I mean, I'm a passionate football fan, but it's just a game. It's just a game. But anyway, so happy birthday to Fraser. Our first hymn this morning is Go Tell It on the Mountain, and if we're able, we stand to sing.
He rose as no branches.
Let's come before God in prayer. Let us all pray. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. Gracious God, we thank you that Jesus was born, that he lived to show us your ways and to teach us your ways, and that he died on the cross that we might be forgiven our sins. But more than that, he rose again on the third day to take away our sins forever. So Lord, help us to declare that on the mountains, in the valleys, and every area that we find ourselves, that Jesus Christ is Lord and is Lord of all. We're sorry for the times when we forget that, for the times when we revert to our old ways, and the times when we don't declare your glory. Forgive us, Lord, restore us each day, that we might declare your good news to the world in which we live. Gracious God, as we meet together in worship, speak to each one of us by your Holy Spirit, that we might know your will for our lives and your plan. In Jesus' name we pray, and as a family in our own languages and traditions, we say the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Our next hymn, we stand if we're able and we sing, All to Jesus I surrender all.
All to Jesus I surrender, all to thee I freely give.
Myself to thee. I surrender all.
Reading this morning is from Matthew 28, reading from verses 16 to 20, and will be read by Brian.
I thought you might have just stood up here. Matthew 28, 16 to 20. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age." Amen, and thanks be to God.
Thank you, Brian. And Bible readers don't think you're going to get away with four verses very often, but Mike, Michael has been very kind to Brian this morning. Our next hymn, and after this, I'm going to hand over to Michael to take us through to the end of the service, but we stand if we're able and we sing, "Lord, You Have Come to the Seashore."
Follow
Speak, O Lord, and cause our hearts to perceive your direction. Amen. It's a lovely morning. Yeah, rainy, but it's a blessing. And this morning, we are remembering a very interesting theological concept that has gone through various arguments, and people argue so much about it because the word is not found anywhere in the Bible, and that is Trinity. However, the concept of Trinity runs through Genesis to Revelation. So it's a doctrinal truth that we don't need to argue about. For us Christians, Trinity is real. And today, I'll be sharing what I titled The Role of Trinity in Mission. The Role of Trinity in Mission. Considering the fact that our church is undergoing a mission process. The passage from Matthew chapter 28, 16 to 20, commonly known as the Great Commission, captures a pivotal moment after Jesus' resurrection. You remember, we just celebrated Easter a few weeks ago, and then after that, we celebrated the Passover, Pentecost a few weeks ago, and that's last week, sorry. And then today we are dealing with Trinity. Jesus had met with his disciples in Galilee, as we read this morning. And what follows after that meeting is a charge that reverberates through time and space. That's the Great Commission. A mission that transcends generations. As we explore Matthew 28:16-20, we will uncover the profound role that the Trinity, that's the divine God, the great one who made all things, whom we call three in one, will find out the divine role he is playing in mission. And the first area I want us to look at in that text is Jesus telling his disciples, "All authority has been given unto me." Verse 18. Then in verse 19, he says, "Go and make disciples of all nations." The authoritarian, the Trinitarian authority giving unto the disciples to preach the word of God. Jesus at this point has conquered sin and conquered death. He had at this point overcome the world. He has overcome Satan and all his cohorts. And he is now charging the disciples to go. And the word go carries authority. You are delegated. You have been given an assignment with the backing of the Trinity. Go and extend the gospel to people of all nations, people of all colors, people of all races, male, female, no matter the gender, no matter the tribe. Share this gospel from Jerusalem, move down to all Judea, get down through Samaria, and then to the utmost part of the world. This is an incredible assignment that Jesus was giving to his disciples. And he knows very well that it is an assignment they cannot really do with their own theological understanding or with their own personal experiences, as they may tell, you know, further in the stories, in the Gospels, but they needed the backing of Trinity. It is the support of God, the triune God, in mission that success is usually achieved. You cannot experience the grace of expansion in mission when the triune God and the authority that comes through him is kept by the side. Of course, the disciples immediately moved in after they had received the power of the Holy Spirit, and they began to travel from nation to nation. And history has it that Andrew traveled to Greece, where he shared the gospel with philosophers and poets. Andrew had time to share the word of God with philosophers, people who were known as elites, people who knew and who were searching for truth, people who were looking to know more about truth. James, the son of Zebedee, went to Spain and preached courageously despite the persecution that he encountered. Bartholomew, known for his honesty, journeyed to India and carried the gospel fire and spread it among the hungry seekers of truth in India. Philip, the practical thinker, headed to Ethiopia in Africa and preached the gospel in Africa. Of course, you remember the Ethiopian eunuch that was his first convert. Paul, who was a persecutor of the church, at encountering Jesus, became a missionary. And his word echoes through generations when he cited the Old Testament passage in Romans chapter 10, verse 15, and said, "How beautiful are the feet of those who bring good tidings." Despite facing persecutions and hardship, the disciples were fueled by the love of Jesus Christ and the support of the triune God, whose authority they carry. Their mission continued through centuries. It reached the medieval Europe. It passed through the Silk Road and then the New World. Today, we are part of this story, taxed with the same mission to make disciples. The authority that the Trinity has given to us is still active upon us. The second point is the Trinity in baptism. Jesus had instructed the disciples to baptize those who had believed in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. That's verse 19. as they baptized these new believers, they remembered the triune presence. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The Trinity, the mystery that bound them together, was their anchor. And even today, the Trinity is still the mystery that binds the church together. And that's our anchor. This triune formula encapsulates the essence of God's nature. It reveals the eternal dance of love within the Godhead. The Father initiating things to be done, the Son redeeming the world, and the Spirit empowering those that believe. Baptism, of course, symbolizes our identification with the Trinitarian community, inviting us into a relationship with each divine person. The Trinity is shown in our teaching and our command to obey. Beyond baptism, Jesus emphasizes teaching and obedience. Discipleship involves more than mere conversion. It is a lifelong journey of learning and following. And I will, at this juncture, still remind us that there is a process, a learning process going on in the church every Wednesday. And for those who have been participating, they have been giving amazing testimonies of how God is helping them understand better what he is saying in the Gospel book of John. We teach others not just the facts about Jesus, but also the way of life he modeled for us. The Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, actively participate in this process of teaching. Remember, Jesus told the disciples in John chapter 16, verse 8 to around 12, that when the Spirit comes, the Holy Spirit comes, he will remind them all things. He will lead them into all truth. He will guide them on the path. He will comfort them. So the Holy Spirit is our teacher. Just as Jesus was teaching the disciples, the Holy Spirit today is teaching us. Just as the Father gave the commandment unto Moses, the same thing the Holy Spirit is doing today. The Trinity is actively involved in the process of teaching. You cannot know the truth unless you are taught by the Spirit. You cannot teach the truth unless the Holy Spirit has revealed the truth to you. That was why Jesus said, we need the Holy Spirit. The Trinity is involved in making disciples. We can't keep the Trinity by the side. When we share the gospel, we echo the harmonious unity in the triune God. Our feeble efforts find resonance in their eternal work. The Trinity gave us another powerful assurance that keeps us moving in our contemporary time as believers. The Trinity is with us. Verse 20 of Matthew chapter 28. Jesus says, and lo, I am with you even to the end of times. Jesus concludes this great commission with that promise. This assurance transcends time and seasons and circumstances. The Trinity, the indivisible yet distinct, accompanies us anytime we get involved in mission. As we go forth, we carry the weight of this divine commission, knowing that the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit are our constant companions. In summary, beloved in the Lord, fulfilling the Great Commission is a goal for every believer. not just those who have been licensed or ordained as ministers. It is an assignment to every one of us. And we can do it using any method the Holy Spirit gives to us or shows to us. You may do it by opening a conversation with someone by your side, your neighbors, your children, your parents, your wife, your husband. You can do it by showing an act of mercy to people. You can do it by living the life of Christ. You can do it by giving out tracts or printed materials that carry the message of the gospel. There are so many ways we can carry out the Great Commission. But what God, the triune God, expects for us is to go. During the General Assembly, the moderator spoke on this text, and one of the comments he made that caught my attention more was that Jesus did not say come, that Jesus said go, but that the church today is saying come to the church, instead of going to the community to tell the people. And that was amazing to hear. Preaching the gospel is very important. Baptizing those who have converted is also so important. Teaching regularly the word of God is very much important. And these, the triune God, will always be involved in. As Christians, we are taxed with replicating ourselves by making disciples among those who respond to Christ's message of salvation. It is important to note that believers do not have to struggle to fulfill the Great Commission. No, because they can't do it alone. The Holy Spirit is there. The triune God empowers us and convince people who hear the word from our mouth of the need for salvation. The success of this mission hinges on Christ Jesus, who promised to always be with us, and we carry out this assignment with him. Both his presence and his authority will always accompany and accomplish his purpose through us. The Great Commission invites us into the Trinitarian dance of authority, baptism, teaching, and the eternal presence of God. May we embrace this mission, empowered by the triune God, as we go out to proclaim Christ to our neighbors, to our friends, to our families, to the community. But remember what Isaiah said when he encountered God in Isaiah chapter 6. He said he heard God, the triune God, saying, "Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?" And then Isaiah responded, "Here I am. Lord, please send me." Can you also say the same thing, even as you have heard his word? Amen. To continue in this service, we'll take our offerings as we sit down to sing the hymn, "God Forgive My Sins Freely, Freely." You will sit down to sing. As he Let us pray. All-knowing God, we come with thanksgivings in our heart, thanking you for your word, whom you sent unto us, and he became flesh and dwelt amongst us. He died and conquered death by giving himself. We were brought into fellowship with you, so we thank you that we are blessed by your love. And we give unto you our body, our soul, and our spirit to be a living sacrifice unto you. Accept all our offerings today, and let all be to the glorification of your name and building of your church. You've charged us to go. We therefore ask of you, Lord, to strengthen us as a church with this mandate as we go into the community. May we share the love of Christ with our neighbors, with our friends. Give us the grace to declare that Jesus is Lord. We pray, thanking you for the success of the General Assembly. And we ask that you help the church as different decisions have been reached, that all will be implemented in line with your guidance and your spirit. And as we do, help the church to keep advancing to the glory of your name. And in this generation where people are keeping away from worshiping you, we ask that the Spirit of God, the presence of the Triune God, would go ahead of us into communities, into lives, into homes, and cause a divine encounter that will cause adding people to your kingdom every day in this part of the world and in the whole world at large. Bring peace in countries where there are wars. Comfort to people who have undergone and are still going through situations that are unbearable. Healing, oh Lord, to those who are passing through health challenges, whether in the hospital or at home or in church. May your grace of healing be extended to your church, to your children, and to the entire community. We surrender all to you, and we are trusting you that this week will be a week we will return with testimonies of your faithfulness. All this and more we ask you through Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. The last hymn we will sing as we stand, Men of Faith.
Men of faith, rise up and sing of the great and glorious King. You are strong when you feel weak, in your brokenness complete. Shout to the north and the south, sing to the east and the west,
and the west. Jesus is Savior to all, Lord of heaven and earth.
Go in peace, and may the Lord of peace cause his peace to rule your heart and that of your loved ones, even now and evermore. Amen. Please be seated for the stated annual meeting as I hand over.
Thank you, Michael. We'll just have a 2-minute comfort break, as they called it, or circulation break. So if you need to go to the loo, you've got basically until we put that table in front. So go. And make sure you've got some papers. They were out the front this morning.